Lord, once again, can you clap your hands and let's lift him up together? It's a great day to be in the house of the Lord with all of the saints of God, and we're excited about what God is going to do in this service for us this morning. As I was saying earlier to you, I get excited when it's time to come together as we gather here, whether we're in person or in online. And so all of our online people are joining in, and they're signing in. So we welcome you as well, whether you're tuning in your car or work or wherever you are this morning. Good morning and welcome back to another service here at City Cathedral. And like I ask every time I see you, we want to see you in person real soon. Anytime that you have the opportunity to join us, take it. Join us at our Woodlands campus at 8:30 a.m. or our Houston campus here at 10:30 a.m. You can log on to our website at www.citycathedral.com for service times and information about our ministry. As a matter of fact, we're going to share our praise press announcements with you to keep you informed about everything that's happening here at City Cathedral for this month and beyond. Let's welcome them back in once again, City Cathedral. Amen.
Preparations are underway for the 45th annual Thanksgiving Super Feast that will be held once again at the George R. Brown Convention Center on Thursday, November 23rd. There are volunteer opportunities available, and we are accepting donations of clothing, canned goods, and other non-perishable items, and frozen turkeys. For more information, call 713-752-2552. Thanks in advance for your support. Mark your calendars now for the annual KWS Health Fair on Saturday, October 21st from 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. on the campus of U of H to learn more about improving your physical health and well-being.
The explanation of God's word is that Bible does not contain the word, not just contain the word, it is the word of the Lord. The explanation of the text in the Greek tongue is graphe, G-R-A-P-E, or this English word graphics. It is the face of God in writing, because none of us can just say that I know what God looks like. But what we can collectively say that God looks like his word.
It was wonderful, wonderful. Life-changing experience.
It was amazing.
Did you enjoy the service?
I did. It was really good.
Join us for the next quarterly Empowerment Symposium on today, immediately following morning worship in the Conference Center at the Houston campus. Come and learn more about life insurance, health and wellness, credit repair management, living wills and trust, and increasing your wealth. And it's all free. Road to the polls. Remember, Election Day is Tuesday, November 7th, and early voting starts October 23rd through November 3rd. Exercise your constitutional right to vote. Anyone needing a ride to cash your vote, please call 346-588-1233 to arrange transportation. Remember, if you want to know the happenings this week, please reference our weekly City Columns publication. Don't forget to patronize our family business. The Agape Ministry is sponsoring First Lady's birthday. The celebration will take place on Sunday, November 12th, during Sunday morning worship service. Everyone is encouraged to give their very best towards this endeavor. Let's honor her with our gifts, love, and appreciation. Get ready for the annual Man in Demand Conference on Sunday, October 29th at 8:30 a.m. at the Woodlands campus and 10:30 a.m. at the Houston campus, with special musical guest Endurance, with Minister Jason Keaton and Bishop Richard Rose as our speakers, featuring the Men of Judah Male Chorus. You don't want to miss it. Do you want to further your Christian education? Enroll today in the Cananea Theological College. Scholarships are available. Please sign up today or call the business office for more information. Exciting! Do you love Starbucks? Then no need to stop before church to get your fix. Our very own coffee cafe is open each Sunday. Stop in and enjoy before or after service. And I'm your announcing clerk, Ricky K. Williams, with the City Cathedral Praise Press Live.
Come on and put your hands together in this place. Are you ready to bless him? Come on, are you ready to honor the name of Jesus? Make a joyful noise unto the Lord. Come on. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Here we are. Let's get on one accord. Leave all your problems on the outside. To be consumed with the Holy Ghost fire. Open up your mouth and lift the name of Jesus higher. Say, are you ready for your blessing? Are you ready? Come on, I need to hear you. For you, for the chains that come from the enemy are utterly destroyed. For the praises to ring, sing hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. He's exalted forever. So, no one above. Just put your hands together and let the praise begin. Yeah, yeah. Come on, I need to hear you. Yeah, 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 yeah. I know it might be tough to get your praise on. The trials of life been catching you all week long. If you don't have a reason to praise him, let me give you one. He gave you a brand new mercy with the rising of the sun. Say, are you ready? Come on. Are you ready for your miracle? For the chains that come from the enemy are utterly destroyed. From the praises to ring, sing hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. He's exalted forever, so. He's exalted forever, so hallelujah, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. Come on, he's exalted forever, so oh, Lord, I love you. Come on, no one above. Put your hands together, sing. Everybody sing, are you ready? Are you ready? The praises to ring, sing, raise up, sing the praise up. Come on, raise up, sing the praise up. Sing, raise up, sing the praise up. Sing, he's here right now. Come on, say, raise up, sing the praise up. Come on, sing, raise up, sing the praise up. Raise up, sing the praise up. Sing, he's here. I don't care what you got to do, but what you need to know is in the way. It's in your praise. 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 And because you praise him, know this. Right now. Right now. He's here. Right now. He's here. Come on. He's here, right now. He's here. Put your hands together, come on. Come on, the presence of the Lord is here. Come on, let's sing it. Everybody sing. Are you ready? Are you ready for? Are you ready for your miracle? For the chains that come from the enemy are utterly destroyed. When the praises ring, are you ready? Oh, are you ready for your miracle? For the chains that come from the enemy are utterly destroyed. When the praises ring, sing, raise up, sing. Come on and lift them in this place. Come on, clap your hands just like this. I want you to find somebody that says, nobody like our God. Come on, find somebody that says, there's nobody like our God.
Nobody like you, Lord, you.
It's real simple.
Nobody like, there is nobody like you, Lord. I can look throughout this world, search eternity, I am sure. Oh, no one loves, I'm for sure. There is no, so we take this time to say, there, come on, nobody, nobody like, nobody like, come on, say nobody, nobody like, there is nobody like you, Lord, you, oh, no one loves me like you do, I'm for sure, this is so true, there is nobody. So we take this time to say, I can look throughout this world, and yet I know, come on and say, I won't find. I can search eternity, and I am sure that I won't find. No one loves me like you do, I'm for sure, this is so true, there is nobody like. So we take this time to say that there, come on, nobody, nobody like, nobody like you, Lord. Come on, let me hear, sing, nobody, nobody like, there is nobody like you, Lord. Nobody, nobody like, there is nobody like. Come on and lift it in this place. Say nobody, there is nobody like him, no. Come on, repeat after me, everybody. Sing, there is none, there is none. Come on, lift it up and say, there is none. There is. I need to hear today, there is none. Y'all sound good. Everybody sing, there is none. Sing it again, say, there is none, no, no, no. No, no, there. Say there is none. Say there. Say there is none. We gonna sing that again. Everybody say there's nobody like our God, our ruler and our redeemer. Say there. I can't find nobody. Jesus, nobody like Jesus. Nobody.
Nobody like Jesus.
Come on, help us sing it. Nobody like him.
Nobody like Jesus.
Nobody.
Nobody.
Nobody. Nobody like him. Come on, how do you believe that today there's nobody like him? I search high and I look low.
Nobody like Jesus.
No, 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 no.
Nobody.
Hey. Nobody like him, no. Nobody like him, no, 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 no.
Nobody.
Hey, hey, nobody. I believe he's our ruler and our redeemer. Hey, can't find. There just ain't nobody. Can't find nobody. Say nobody.
Nobody.
I can't find. There just. Come on. There just ain't no. Can't find nobody. Say nobody.
Nobody.
Nobody like. Nobody like. Come on, I need to hear. Nobody like. Come on, open up your mouth and declare it. Make a declaration that's nobody.
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 nobody, nobody, my Savior, my healer, my Redeemer, the present help in the midnight hour. He's always on time. He's a great and a mighty God. Nobody, nobody who can heal me, who can feel me. Nobody, the great and mighty King. No, 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 no. Put your hand in. Come on. Celebrate them. Come on, celebrate them. Come on, come on. Lift them in this place. Say, nobody. 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 Oh, no, no, no. No, 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 no. No, 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 no. No, 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 no. No, no, nobody. No, no, nobody. He is my Savior. He keeps me in perfect peace. He leads and guides me. He orders my steps in His Word. Nobody. Nobody like you. Nobody like you. Nobody. No, 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 nobody. Nobody. No, no. Come on and give Him a praise. When I think about the goodness of Jesus, I try to control myself. I try to contain it. But it's something about the name of Jesus. My hands get to waving. My feet get to moving. Come on, He's a good God. He's a mighty God. He's a kind God. He's a saving God. He's a healing God. Say nobody. No, 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 no. No, 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 no. No, 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 no. No, 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 no. Hey, put your... Say, nobody, nobody, nobody who can fix every problem and every issue. He's concerned about you. He cares for you. He'll keep you. He'll cover you. Protect you. He'll shield you. He'll fight your battles. Nobody. No, no, nobody. Nobody. Will you help us celebrate Him in this place? Nobody like Jesus. Nobody like Jesus. Nobody like Jesus. Nobody like Him. Nobody. Nobody like Jesus. Nobody like Jesus. Nobody like Jesus. Let me see your hand. Nobody. Come on. Nobody, nobody like Jesus. Nobody like Jesus. Nobody like Jesus. Nobody, nobody, nobody like Jesus. Nobody like Jesus. Come on. Nobody like a Savior. Come on, sing it. Nobody. Nobody. I need to hear you. Nobody,
nobody,
nobody, nobody, nobody, nobody. Come on and make it loud and proud. Nobody, I declare that there's nobody, not Buddha, not Confucius, not my mother, not my father, not my sister, not even my best friend. There is nobody that could ever compare to my God. And my Savior, He is my Father. I can look to the hills. No, it's not in my hell. No, no, no. No, no, no. Come on and bless Him in this place. Come on, don't play with Him. Come on, don't play with him. Give him what he deserves. Give him what he deserves. Give him what he deserves. Give him what you owe him. Give him what you owe him. Come on, come on, come on, come on. Press into his presence. Come on, come on. The fresh wind, fresh anointing. Come on. I don't know about you, but I don't want to be left behind. Come on, come on. I want to be where you are. If you're not there, I don't want to be there. If he's not there, I don't want to be there. Draw us in. Pull us in. We bless you, we lift you, we honor you, we adore you, we salute the King, we reverence him, nobody greater, no name higher, we love you Jesus, we love you Jesus, we love you, we love you, we love you, we love you, we love you. How worthy he is.
My God, how great you are. How great you are.
Oh, thank you, Lord, for being great and mighty.
My God, how great you are. How great you are. And we sing hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
Everybody sing, all will see.
All will see, all will see.
how great.
How great.
Everybody sing it.
Is our God.
Sing with me.
Sing with me.
How great.
Is our God.
Is our God.
I hear your voice. How great.
How great.
Yes, he is. Yes, he is. Yes, he is. Yes, he is. Come on. Yes, he is. Yes, he is. Come on. Yes, he is. 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 Come on. Sing. Yes, he is. 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 I find my hope in you. I find my joy in you. I find my peace in you. Sing, yes, he is. Yes, he is. Yes, he is. The Holy One, the Saving One, Deliverer, Deliverer. Come on, Deliverer, 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 Deliverer. He'll break every chain. Everything has to come under subjection. Yes, he is. Yes, he is. My Redeemer. My Waymaker. Miracle working God. 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 Sing, yes, he is. Yes, he is. I'm going to walk by faith and not by sight. Because yes, he is. Yes, he is. Yes, he is. My provider. My provider. My provider. Yes, he is. Put your hands together. Anybody coming in this place? Nothing can change my mind. Nothing can change my mind. Everybody sing. Yes, he is. Yes, he is. Yes, he is. Yes, he is. I walk by faith and not by sight. It's already done. It's already done. Every need will be met. There will be no lack. There will be no lack. But an overflow. But an overflow. But an overflow. Yes, he is. Yes, he is. I will be blessed. You will be blessed. Your children will be blessed. Yes, he is. He's a loving God. He's a healing God. Oh, yes, he is. Everybody give him a praise. Now, I want you to quote this throughout this week. I don't care what you may go through. I don't care what you may face. Don't you say, yes, it is. I will not be depressed. I come against every anxiety. Yes, he is. I'ma press in and I'm gonna push on. I will not be discouraged. I will not be defeated because yes, he is. Yes, he is. Yes, he is. I'ma look to the hills because yes, he is. Yes, he is. Yes, he is. Yes, he is. I want to challenge you this morning to make the enemy mad. Can we do this together? Can we make them mad? Everybody sing. Yes, he is. 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 My provider. Yes, he is. Yes, he is. The Holy One, the Saving One, my Deliverer. He carries me and he covers me. Yes, he is. Yes, he is. Yes, he is. Come on, don't stop praising him in this place.
Yes, yes. Come on and lift him up. Come on and lift him up. Come on and lift him up. We've been declaring who he is. We've been testifying of who he is. Now let your words match your actions. we honor him. We're lifting him up, exalting him above whatever's going on, making him bigger than whatever our situation is, because he is God, and he cannot be defeated. He cannot be destroyed. He cannot lose. We serve an awesome God. We serve a mighty God. Victorious is his name. Wonderful is his name. Majestic is his name. Holy is his name. Jesus is his name. Can you just call his name Jesus? Can you just call his name Jesus? Fill this place with your shout. Fill this place with your victory cry. Jesus. 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 Jesus.
Come on.
Jesus. That's who he is. That's his name. Jesus. 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 They tell me when you call that name, situations change. Jesus. At that name, demons tremble. At that name, healing takes place. At that name, strongholds destroyed. Jesus. Jesus. Who do you love? Who do you worship? Who do we serve? His name is Jesus. My God. Jesus. Jesus. I love him. I love him. I thank him. I bless him. I lift him. I adore him. I came to give him glory. Help me bless him. Help me honor him. Help me bless him. Help me give him praise. He's been good. He's never failed me. He's always there. He's always there. He never lies. He never loses. His ways are true. His word is right. His love never fails. He's merciful. He's kind. He's forgiving. Always on time. When I thought I would lose it, he stepped in and he rescued me. He sustains me. He turned me around. He changed my name. He lifted me up. He renewed my joy. He did it for you like he did for me. That's why we can come together and all agree he's the greatest, oh, powerful, everlasting, awesome King, mighty God, my Lord. We lift him. We love him. Yeah. I thank him. Yeah. I bless him. Cause he lives. Cause he rules. He is good. He's great. Thank him. Everybody, lift him. Everybody, bless him. My God. My God. Now let's exalt his name, everybody.
Come on. Something about the name. Something about the name of Jesus.
Let's lift his name. I can't hear you. I can't hear you. Let's lift his name. Let's lift his name. He's a great God. I feel something good is about to take place. I feel God moving in this place right now. It's in your praise. It's in your praise. The breakthrough that you need is right there. Reach up and proclaim it. Use your weapon. Use your authority. And let's lift him up. Yes, God. The devil is mad now. He didn't want you to make it here. He put every stumbling block in your way just so you couldn't come and call on the name of Jesus. He didn't want you to get here. He didn't want you to sit next to your neighbor because he knew that there would be some power that would transfer. Because he's been good to me, I got enough praise in me to set the devil loose from you. He's a wonderful God. Thank you, Jesus. 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 That's what I came to say. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. That's what I came to tell you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I came to say it. I came to declare it. My God is good. Hallelujah. 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 In the bottom of my soul. Hallelujah. 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 Oh, you see, there's more of you than there are of me, so I'm gonna need some help. I'm gonna need some help. I need you to help me lift him. Help me. Can you help us up here? Can you help us up here? Can we break the roof off of this place? Talking about how good God has been. Hey! Jesus. Oh God. You ought to lift those hands in this place and begin to bless his name because he's awesome. Just because he's God. Just because he's God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Oh, bless the name of Jesus. He's such a sweet, loving God. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Oh, we bless you, we bless you, we bless you. Oh, yes, God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, Lord. Oh, God. Hallelujah. Yes, Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, yes, move, God. Hallelujah. Yes. Oh, yes, tell him hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Yes, everybody, all together. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Oh, God.
Hallelujah.
Yes, hallelujah.
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 One more time. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Oh yes, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Lord, we love you.
Lord, we love you.
Hallelujah.
Lord, we love you.
Lord, we love you.
Lord, we love you.
Lord, we love you.
Lord,
one more time, Lord, we love you.
Lord, we love you.
Yes, God, Lord, we love you.
Lord, we love you.
Lord, we love you. Yes, Lord, Lord, we love you.
Lord, we love you.
Lord, we praise you. Lord, we praise you in the sanctuary.
Lord, we praise
hey.
You. Yes.
With the fruit of our lips, Lord, we praise you.
Lord, we praise.
Say hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hey,
hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Oh yes, hallelujah, hallelujah. Fill this place with the clapping of your hands. Hallelujah. Oh yes, clap them like your strength has been renewed. Clap those hands like your joy has increased. Clap your hands like you know that God is hearing and answering every one of your prayers. Clap those hands all over the sanctuary. Hey, hey, hey. Oh God, oh God. Thank you, Jesus. for the victory. Thank you, Jesus, for your mighty victory, oh God. Hallelujah. You ought to touch your neighbor and say, neighbor, we've got the victory. Neighbor, we've got the victory. Neighbor, we've got the victory. Tell them like you know, for sure, for sure, for sure. Neighbor, we have got the victory. As a matter of fact, I don't know what it is that you're battling. I don't know what circumstance you're trying to overcome. But I came to let you know that we've got the victory. You got to tell them, if they don't want to go with it, find somebody else and say, we've got the victory. You can tell somebody, look across the other side of the church and say, neighbor, we've got the victory. How do you know we've got it? Because he gave it to us on the cross. How do you know we've got it? Because his word says that we are overcomers. Hallelujah. How do you know we've got it? Because no matter who's against us, God has already declared it to be so. You ought to tell another neighbor, say, neighbor, we've got the victory. Yeah, yeah, it might be bloody, it might not look like you thought it was gonna look, but I came to tell you that you've got the victory. Hey, we've got it, we've got it, we've got it, we've got it. Now if you know it, clap your hands and be glad about it. Everybody clap your hands. Everybody clap your hands. Bless the name of Jesus. Hallelujah.
Oh, tell me, who can stand before us when we call on that great name? Name is Jesus. Jesus. Come on, sing it.
Precious Jesus, can we go to school? I need the old. I need thee. Y'all help me. Every hour. Oh, I need thee. Hey, 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 yeah. I come. I come to you, to thee. It was there. Precious name, glory to his name. There too, my God, was the blood applied. Glory to, we could have been in an accident. Glory. to. I'm about to go to the next level, but I feel a stronger knowing. Glory to. Yeah, to those who are online, to y'all don't steal my Baptist, to his name. Somebody say, yeah. And clap those hands and bless the name. I need you to. In the book, I just had to get that out. I just had to get that out. In the book of John. In the book of John, chapter 13. Verse 1, let's skip the Bible confessional. But it was just before the Passover meal feast. Bishop Rose, Jesus knew that time had come for him to leave this world and go to heaven. Having loved his own who were in the world, and he now showed them the full extent of his love. The evening meal was being served, and the devil had already prompted Judas Iscariot, son of Simon, to betray Jesus. Don't let the devil get in your brain. Jesus knew that the Father had put all these things under his power, and that he had come from God and was returning to him. So he got up from the meal table, took off his outer garment, wrapped a towel around his waist, Deacon Thomas. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash feet, Minister Hatter. He began to wash his disciples' feet, drying them with the towel that was wrapped around him. He came to Simon Peter, as it were, Brother Lionel, who said to him, Lord, are you going to wash my feet? Jesus replied, You do not realize now what I'm doing, but later you will understand. Peter said, no, you should never wash my feet. Jesus answered, unless I wash your feet, you have no part with me. Then, Lord, Simon Peter replied, not just my feet, hand, head, and everywhere else. Jesus answered, a person who had a bath needs only to wash his feet. His whole body is cleansed and cleaned. And you are clean, though not everyone. He's talking about Judas. For he knew who was going to betray him. And that was why he said not everyone was clean. When he finished washing their feet, Minister Juanita, he put his clothes back on and returned to the head table. Do you understand what I've done for you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you're right. But now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also shall wash one another's feet. I have set you an example.
I've given you a prototype. I've become your theological template. Do as I did. For no servant is greater than his master. Now that you know these things, you will be blessed, contingent, if you do them. I want to use as a clarion to this little piece, part three, explain and experience. You may be seated before the affidavit of the Lord, lest I hold you too long. I'm very delighted. I see my personal trainer here, so I've got to be at my better behavior. Yes, God bless Brother Lionel. Yes. The body is an incredible, it's a beautiful slave, but a bad master. And so there's some things that we have to do physically. To our live audience, let's give them a welcome. And then all of our visitors, those that are in U Church, come on, we can do better than that. Let them hear the applauses. Minister Russell, God bless you. Are y'all happy to be here? That was an overtime anointing that lingered at our Woodlands campus. And so we couldn't rush to bed. I come in peace. Amen. So I want you to underscore the background scripture from the book of John, chapter 13, verses 1 through 17, as we just read. I want you to underscore the word experience, because the word experience in the Hebrewic tongue is the word narkish, N-A-C-H-A-S-H, or the understanding to prophetically experience the reality of the word. Not after, not prior to your understanding, rather, God's word by way of explanation. You cannot experience what you don't understand. So the explanation of the word is having a deeper understanding by way of comprehension. And that's why I give you these theological receipts and these proofs of the text. I give you verses, and I take the time to teach you and to show you, because I really want you to get it in terms of the understanding of God's holy writ. The Lord wants you to understand the written word, but he also doesn't want you to just park yourself in understanding the written word, but he also wants you to cause what you understand become applicable to your now. So, in order for us to apply God's word based on the comprehension, based on the understanding of what he says, it is important, child of God, that we apply God's word. That's why in the book of James, chapter 1, verses 22 through 26, it says, let us not just be hearers by way of explanation from a place of comprehension, but also let us be doers in terms of experiencing your prophetic reality. Because what good of it is to read all of God's holy writ and not experience the prophetic reality of it? And one of the ways that you do it, because Paul had to have some type of medical, biological, anatomical training. For he talked about skeletons and bones. He talked about that if the body is affixed from oxygen, it ultimately dies. So it is a man without faith dies, because your doingness, your practice, Minister Green, becomes an oxygen to the written word. And it calls that which is written become living in the relevance of your now. How then can the oldest book be as young as young? Is when it is as old as old. The Bible is antiquated, and yet it is right now, it's current. The Bible, the Biblion, or the little books by which the big book is composed, It's bigger than any book, better than any book, most read than any book in the world. And yet it is the oldest book, and yet it is the youngest book that has ever been read. It can never run out of style. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Look at your neighbor next door and say, neighbor, it's just a good book. In the book of Psalm chapter 19, it says, it's sweeter than a honeycomb. It'll give you sugarcane hotness. Latte ready. Is that when you read it from a place of understanding, it gives you this type of addiction. That's why my trainer used to tell me that they put three ingredients in food to keep you coming to it. Grease, salt, and sugar. Praise the Lord. And it keeps you coming to it. Because the word ought to be addictive. Have you ever like been on a fast from the word and like you like, something ain't right this week. I don't feel, it's just, I don't have my biblical rhythm on. And it's not until you get into your prophetic favorite song or you read some type of scripture and all of a sudden you get some type of electrolytes. and it causes your body to feel better. You become hydrated. Through the understanding of God's holy writ, if I may remove the macrocosm to the microcosm, and then express to you, the Lord just doesn't want you to be hearers, but he wants you to prophetically experience the reality of God's holy writ. Preach, Bishop. But it is contingent on our taking the time and practicing is likened to oxygen to the word to make it from living, to make it from written to the living word. So we talked about on this apologetics, which is a theological term, those who've been through the Cunningham Theological College or any kind of formal training that you are familiar with the term apologetics. Apologetics is really giving criticism on the doctrine without being dogma. Then one of the first doctrine is the doctrine of the church. We talked about that. We talked about the origin, the order, and the operation of the church. That we are the body of Christ, and yet Christ is bride. I don't care if you are a man, you are the bride of God. And ain't that God is homosexual. And I heard it taught. I said, what is that? If we can believe that Eve came out of Adam, and Eve was Adam's bride, and yet his body, it ought to be simple for us to believe that we came out of the loins of Jesus Christ. That he wants us all. He ain't sharing the bed with no other lover. He says, you are my body and my bride. We know that Adam came from the dirt, the dust of the earth, and Jesus blowed in his nostrils the breath of life. But he came through the corridors of the woman too as well. That's why the Bible says that Eve was the mother to all the living. So it is possible Eve became out of the body that came out of the Eve. So we are the body of Christ, thus the bride of Christ. The Lord just wants us like that. Look at your neighbor next door and say, neighbor, God just wants you like that. So the orbiting of church was birthed after resurrection and before the day of Pentecost when Peter preached that gospel. 3,000 were saved and thus the church was born. And the Bible says that this particular acceptance was done through Peter's confession. The church was not rendered based on Peter. So Catholicism ain't right. Look at y'all afraid. I ain't going through man. Jesus Christ is my high priest. Because I don't know if you can keep a secret or not. I found out that everybody got a best friend. The church was established based on the confession of Peter. Upon this rock I will build my church. When Jesus says, upon what you confessed. Not upon Peter as the keys to the kingdom. He says the keys are given to those who receive Jesus Christ. And whatsoever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatsoever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. You have the keys to the kingdom. So you don't have to be defeated if you don't want to. Look at your neighbor next door and say, neighbor, I got the key that can transform the opposite.
I wish I had somebody here. So if you're going through a cloudy day, you have a key to reverse the curse. Look at your neighbor next door and say, neighbor, I have the keys to the kingdom. If you are sick, I can unlock healing. If you're in trouble, I can unlock peace. If you're sad, I can unlock joy. I don't care if you have haters in your life. Those who are wearing love glasses never see your haters, no way. Look at your neighbor next door and say, neighbor, I'm wearing love glasses. I don't see what you see. I don't see my hater. All right. I come in peace, y'all. All right. So the origin of church is that we are the body of Christ. In the book of Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10, it says that we are God's workmanship and masterpiece. In the book of Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10, and watch this, and we've been ordained for the ministry, watch this, of three things: obedience, salvation, and servitude. Before we can serve others, we got to make sure that we're serving God. That this ministry was already, watch this, ordained before the foundation of God. It's called pro-evangelion. New Testament being filled in New Testament being filled in Old Testament. So he established this ministry long before we were thought of, according to Scripture. For we are God's handiwork created in Jesus Christ to do what? Good works. And the good works is that was prepared in advance for us to do is the work of obedience. God carved out the path of obedience, salvation, and servitude. We talked about salvation on last week in terms of salvation is really the finished work of the cross. The love of Jesus pinned him to the cross, but the salvation of Jesus was the finished work. When he says, for this is finished, and he gave up the ghost, it is an indication that the curtain was ripped, which means that there is no such thing as denominations. God cares less if you Baptist, Church of God in Christ, which is a salutation, when Paul was saying to the churches of God in Christ as a salutation, not as an organization. I'm ready. They won't call me because I got receipts. Has nothing to do with your being Pentecostal and apostolic. And all of us, every believer is apostolic in terms of believing the apostles' doctrine of healing, prophecy, miracles, and faith and teaching. The apostolic movement has nothing to do with modifying some type of pedagogical perfunctories in terms of dress code. Look at your neighbor next door and say, neighbor, God cares nothing about your dress. He says, man, look at that, but I look at the heart. What makes all of us apostolic is that we believe in the power of healing. We believe in miracles. Do I have any co-signers on that? You ought to believe it. Now, listen, if you don't believe that God can do all things, why are you coming to church? Give me that chair. All right, so he says, for the work of ministry and the work of salvation of which we discussed on last week today, I really want to rest my hat with for the next 15 minutes of your patience. I want to deal with Minister Linda Green is servitude. Servitude, say for me, servitude. There are three points real quickly. I want to deal with the definition of servitude, number two, the demands of servitude, number three, the demonstration of servitude. I'm ready for you. The definition of servitude bespeaks that I am a lover of serving God. I'm a lover, that it's a delight to serve. It's not a duty, it's a delight to serve. It's a lifestyle. In order for me to wear the title of servitude, I have to have a delight in serving. So there are two derivative words that I want to deal with, the word servant. The first word comes from the Hebrewic tongue is abad, A-B-A-D, or the understanding, watch this, to be a worker or a worshiper. It puts you in the mind of Jesus hiring you as his worker. And don't get it twisted, he's CEO, and you never get promoted from being a servant or a worker of Jesus' kingdom. That's why he told his soon-to-be disciples that if you want to follow me, you got to do two things. You have to deny self, take up your willingness to suffer. In other words, that word denia is apomentema. It deals with to disown the warranty deed to your flesh. Check it at the door. In other words, that if you want to join my kingdom, don't get it twisted. You ain't running nothing. So you got to deny the flesh, because sometimes the flesh can flare up. And they want to kind of sort of tell God what to do, when to do it, how to do it, and get disappointed when he doesn't. Ooh, where my rider's at? Come on, holler back at your boy. Come on. And so it is important that you understand that we have to make this conscious decision in order to follow him as a hired hand. As a hired hand. You are hired by God. You are hired by him to serve him. You are hired by him. I'm hired by Jesus Christ to serve him. Y'all, I'm hired. When you look at me, it has nothing to do with my title. I'm hired by God. I work for him. And everything that I do in private and in public should reflect my employer. All right, I'm trying to help somebody here. So I am a worker and a worshiper of Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. That is the first derivative. The second derivative comes from the word diakoneo. It is D-I-A-K-O-N-E-O. It deals with, watch this, to be a waiter, waitress, waiter. There's no male or female in the body of Christ, Jews or Gentiles, to be a waiter of the Lord's church. How many of you, besides me and Deacon Barry, Deacon Thomas and others who've been to a five-star, I ain't mean to put you out there like that, a five-star restaurant? You know, you've taken your significant other and you sit in the five-star restaurant. And part of the reasons why you come back, because good taste food, good service. Worst thing that you can do is try to act bougie before the dessert, because you don't know how they wet that food before they bring it to you. Y'all ain't with me. And sometimes we act a little silly because, I don't want that, I don't want that. Come on now. We come from hog maws, chitlins, and greens, and cornbread. And then we act in a fool because of hush puppies. And you don't understand the origin of hush puppies. Hush puppies was a statement during slavery. That when Harriet Tubman was trying to free the slaves, the only way that they can cause the little babies to stop crying, they would give them cornbread. Call it hush. See, y'all don't need to ask the question. Y'all don't even know the origin of hush puppies. When you eat some cornbread, it ought to hush you up. you ought to feel better. I cook cornbread every week. Look at your neighbor next door and say, neighbor, come on now, hush up, hush up. Give them some cornbread, they'll hush up. So the waiter, what makes you come back is because of good service. What makes the good service, the waiter have good service, is that they are familiar with the menu. So they can explain the ingredients, because I know people that will stop you at the door about ingredients. Yeah. So you got to be familiar with the menu, and you must be familiar with the word. If I am to serve you, I have to know why I'm doing it. The Lord calls us servant because we're students of God's word. You can't be a servant of God if you don't know the menu. You got to know how to serve it up. And you have to not only just know the menu, but you got to have the right mannerism. Lord help. At these five star, we had to back a brother up because he was too close to the table talking. What that happened is, I say, I don't mean no harm, but you got to back up a little bit, brother. fingers dirty, got stuff. How many know I'm a pass today? I don't want nothing. I came to the wrong restaurant. Because the worst thing you can do is try to serve people and you don't know what you're doing. You're not being ethical. You're not having preparation. There is no etiquette. You're all over the table, spitting everywhere. You're mistreating your hire because of the lack of information of the menu and the mannerism. 1 Peter chapter 2 says that we are people of kingdom etiquette, mannerism, royal priesthood, and a holy nation. We ought to know how to serve it up. We ought to know how to hold the dish and know how to name the menu because we have word. If we are to be the servant of God and be the Lord's servant, then we have to be acquainted with menu and mannerism. We can't just serve the Lord's people any kind of way. Got to have your uniform on. Folk got to know you work for the company. Look at that. You know, you driving Miss Daisy and Mr. Dukes, that don't look good representation. We are of the world, but we don't need to be looking like the world. I'm not saying that we need to be dressing out of style. Because Moses says that we got to know the times and the seasons. Enough on that. So we are waiters of the Lord's church. Said with me that we're waiters of the Lord's church. But your gifts are not an exemption for serving. In the book of Ephesians chapter 4, verses 11 through 12, it says that he's given you all of these gifts for the work of service. These gifts of prophesying and speaking in tongues, interpretation of tongues and teaching and faith and miracles. All of these gifts that God has given, the gifts of singing, the gifts of music, the gifts of worship, the gifts of praise, all of those things the Lord has given you for the work of ministry. So just because you are gifted doesn't mean that you are exempted for working in ministry. Let me say it again. In fact, it is a context clue of how much you should work because much is given, much is we required. And you are gifted. I know Paul Regina, she's been singing real hard. Come on, y'all clap for her. She's gifted. Amen. When the Lord blessed me with this money, I'm sending her to Paris after the bed bugs leave. I don't need her coming back. Lord, pray for me. I got spots all over me. Bishop, send me to Europe. But your gifting should make room for you, but also your giftings primarily is for service in the Lord's church. We're not exempt just because we're gifted. You still got to volunteer. Just because you can speak in tongues and see things and discernment of spirits. And I can't work in the food service ministry. I'm too gifted. That's not what the Bible says. Oh, I can't. A few people know me. Baby, you just a YouTube baby. You ain't all that. Podcast, come on. Soon Wi-Fi go out. You go out too. Come on. Right? Whatever. Servitude defines your greatness. In the book of Mark, chapter 9, don't have time to go to it. Verses 34 through 35, that when they were arguing about who the greatness is, then Jesus showed them, unless you are the servant, unless you become the last, only then can you become first in my kingdom. So servitude is defined through your greatness. Greatness is defined through servitude. Great. I'm great in God. Your greatness in God is determined to the degree of how you serve others. From a place of pleasure and delight and not duty. And by the time we finish this, we're going to be washing feet. I ain't talking about physical feet because some of these babies need a manicure. I'm just saying. I'm talking about serving in the spirit realm. Go ahead. See, nothing great can ever be achieved if you hold back from servitude. Let me say it again. Nothing great can ever be achieved if you hold back from servitude. And the proof of your greatness is when you are willing to share the success, the blueprint of your success, to others at risk of them upstaging you. And yet you find comfort in sharing the blueprint. I use Deacon Barry a lot because he doesn't mind sharing the blueprint. Now, sometimes it comes with a cost. Amen. Because I do believe that if you want to be the boss, you got to pay the cost. Amen. Amen. And in this symposium meeting that we'll be having after service, we'll be talking about how to leverage and how to manage your wealth as it relates to your health and to wealth. Because what good of it is to have wealth and your health is jacked up. And so he's going to be teaching you in how to spend less, save more, and invest the rest. And stay away from big ticket items. Learn how to park your money. See, y'all ain't with me here. Lean over to your neighbor next door and say, neighbor, knockoffs ain't bad. Come on, say it again. Knockoffs ain't bad. And so you got to be willing to share your greatness even at the risk of them upstaging you. You're willing. That's when you know that you are in your great place. You're in a place of greatness is when I can give you the recipe. The worst thing you can say, hey, man, where you get that? I don't know. I got the check. Let me check. I don't know when I got that. I just, you know, as a sister in here now, you ask her, man, where'd you get that cologne? What is that? Jesus and God. That's a scatter. That ain't Jesus. Tell me where you got that. You know, you just left from Harwin. Go ahead now. Look at your neighbor next door and say, neighbor, be willing to share. Go ahead and tell them. Be willing to share. It's very important that we understand. There's so much to cover here. It takes something good to fall for something great to fall in place. So as we move from the definition of servitude, we embrace the demands of servitude. Watch this, almost done. The demands of servitude requires, and you've never heard this level of teaching, requires humility. Yeah. It demands humility. Otherwise, your servitude will be preferential and short-lived. You have to serve them not based on the merit system. You have to serve them from a place of humility. Because there are some people that will sometimes make you think twice whether or not if you need to wash their feet. Because there's some fungus going on. There's some situations going on. So I'm like, I don't know. But our servitude is a result. It demands humbleness. It demands humbleness. One can't be on first touch ministry and serving if you ain't humble. You mad, you short-tempered, you unfiltered, unhinged. Wrong ministry to serve in because you're going to be like, come on in, go on, sit. How you doing? How I'm doing? What do you mean how I'm doing? I mean, you know, how you feel? I feel with my hands. Wrong ministry. I'm teaching leaders right now to understand that everybody, 98.9% of workers in the Lord's church are volunteers. So you can't command them to do anything. Not even me. You got folk that are leave paid job. You know they'll leave volunteer. Come on. When you deal with people at their level, they're more likely to receive your leadership. You got to receive them as men. I don't lord over men. I respect them as men. I respect you as a woman. Now, if you go to foolery, I'm going to send for some help. See, y'all ain't with me. It demands humility. I want you to underscore the word humble real quickly. The word humble in the Hebrew is hanavah, A-N-A-V-A-H, or the understanding to assume the appearance of. If I were to take a glass of water, fill it up with water to the brim, you would know if there's water in the glass because it has assumed the appearance and the shape of the glass because it looks just like it. That's what happens when we humble ourselves and serve those who does not deserve our service, and yet we move to do it, not because we're weak, but because we're meek. Meekness is not weakness, it's power under God's control. So I don't mind washing your feet because I resemble God. I'm humble like that. All right, proof in point. All right, go with me to the book of Philadelphia. The book of Philippians chapter 2, Jesus said, I did not think it robbery to be equal with God, so I made myself of no reputation. I didn't have to advertise my godness, and I reduced myself to a bond servant. I serve others because I knew who I was. Because when you know who you are, you don't mind doing what you have become. Because what you have become in terms of servitude does not reduce you to something else. So he humbled himself. And that's what we have to do. In this spiritual pilgrimage, we have to always humble ourselves. Even when folk are caught in sin, the Bible says, she who is spiritual must restore such a one gently. Because only a servant, watch this, can restore a person to a better place. Lord have mercy. When they are caught in some kind of indiscretion, because we're humble and because we're spiritual, we can restore such a one into a better experience, even when they've received upsets in life. But quite to the contrary, sometimes you can come to the church at large, and they know your business, and only will they Facebook it. But they would whip you. They would have you. They'll never forget. The church folk are the most unforgiving people. And that's why a lot of folk, you know, cling to the world, because the world will forgive you. They'll keep passing the drink. They'll keep passing the drink. And see, we don't do that. You know, once you mess up, give me my bottle. Come on. We don't pass the drink. Look at your neighbor next door and say, neighbor, pass the drink, the blood of Jesus. Pass the drink. Come on, pull your mind in. I ain't talking about Ripper. You have to pass it. You got to continue to pass it. And sometimes, now I'm making it very applicable so everybody can understand my point. That's why you keep coming Sunday after Sunday. You have to pass it. You can't, listen, if you've been caught in sin, I have to restore you in the spirit of humbleness. Look at my amens now. I don't know about that. See, we have a problem with somebody else's family member sin, but it's not until your family member sin. And you want everybody to be understanding. See, y'all ain't with me. Oh, boy, we get criticized. Oh, look at that. She had a baby out of wedlock. Not until your baby did. You want everybody to understand. He who is humble must store such a one in the spirit of meekness. We got to return them to a place of positive experience. Meekness is not weakness. It's just power under God's control. And just because I light your flame doesn't mean that my flame goes out. It's because I light your candle doesn't take away my light. What happened if both of us were to put our candles together? Teach, black man. So the demand of humility or servitude requires humility. But then lastly, we move from the definition of servitude, from the demands of servitude, and now to the demonstration of servitude. Because what good of it is for me to tell you to do that and we don't show you in God's holy writ how to pull it off? So in verse 1 in the book of John chapter 13, we just read it as our foundational teaching. Jesus now is pressed for time. He has a flight schedule to heaven. But he postpones the flight schedule so that he can do something in terms of servitude. And while sitting at the table of the Passover meal with the disciples, including Judas, who was plotting to betray Jesus, he delays his flight schedule to heaven. And in verse 4, Jesus now stands up from the meal table, derobe, remove his garb, his outer garment, his cincture, and wraps it around his waist, likened to a house servant, and begins to wash the feet of his disciples. One by one, give me your feet. Where's yours? Give me your feet. Give me your feet, James. Let me wash your feet, John. I know that you're about to deny me, Peter, but I got to wash your feet. I know, Judas, the devil has come in your mind, and many scholars believe that he was the son of perdition, Satan himself in the flesh, trying to copy God as Jesus in the flesh. So I'm going to wash even your feet. Feet was very dirty during those days because of the climate conditions of the Philistines. When the Nile River would crest, it would flood Philistine, and the house servant would have to wash mud and dust from their feet. Washing of feet was a lowly job. But in verse 8, Peter says, no, Jesus, you would never wash my feet. Jesus said, unless I wash your feet, you have no part with me. This was not a behavior of defiance by Peter for rejecting Jesus for washing his feet, but a discomfort of Jesus reducing himself to doing a job of a slave. So in verse 8, Jesus said, unless I wash your feet as a servant, you have no part with me. In verse 9, Jesus said, Peter says, well, in that case, just don't just wash my feet, but wash everything, because if washing my feet secures my fellowship with you, then wash me all over. Wash feet, head, and hands. Because being in your presence is far better than what I have defined as inferior. Verse 10, Jesus said, you are already cleansed, clean as a believer. You're just going to have to stay clean with the washing of the word. Because when your minds are washed by the word, serving others does not diminish your worth, but rather define your elevated relationship with the Father. In other words, just because I serve you, don't make me your servant, but a servant of God. Let me say it once again. Just because I serve you does not make me your servant. I'm just a servant of the Lord. So I can't help myself, because that's what I've been saved for. I've been hired to serve you, not because you have qualified. Because there are a lot of people that are smiling in your face all the time, trying to take your place, those old backstabbers. That does not negate the need for you to serve those that may not necessarily that you feel is qualified. So in verse 12, when Jesus finished, watch this, washing their feet, all 12 of them, he put back on his clothes, and he returned back to the head table. Can I preach it like I feel it? That when he finished washing all 12, your feet, your feet, your feet, your feet, your feet. The Bible says that he put back on his garb. He put back on his regalia. And he returned back to the head table. I wish I had some talk back to me. That when he finished doing the worst expression from a cultural standpoint, from Eastern culture, as a house servant, as a form of greeting, washing dust, mud, dirt from feet fungus. I wish I had somebody. He returned, watch this, to his place, not between Peter, but at the head table. I wish I had some students now. That when he finished, he could not return until he finished washing his disciples, all 12 of them, including Judas. And he returned back to the place of head table. He washed Judas's feet, even when he knew that Judas didn't like it. It's easy to wash feet to your enemy is when your enemy don't know that you know. But it's a whole nother dynamic for me to wash your feet. It's when I know that you know that I'm on to you, and yet I will allow you to take bread, dip it in cup. I wish I had somebody. Eat my food and use my transportation that didn't pay me back on the seventh loan, and yet I'm willing to serve you again. It's a whole nother dynamic. It's for me to wash your bunion feet. Look at your neighbor next door and say, neighbor, but he returned back to place. He returned back to the head table. What is the revelation? The revelation is that your servitude does not exempt you from your status. Just because I serve you, just because I wash your feet spiritually, just because I meet a need in your life, doesn't mean that it is beneath me. The Lord says that I can still return to my place of elevation. I can still return to my place of status. You don't lose your status because I'm serving you. I don't lose who I am. I can still put back on my title. Because in order for me to, watch this, serve you, I've got to take off my censure. I've got to take off my title. You see, I'm only talking to those who doesn't get mad if your name ain't on the program with title. I'm talking to those, amen, who have a problem if my name is not on the program with title. I ain't gonna do nothing because they didn't put my name. They put my name, but they spelled it wrongly. Look at your neighbor one more time and say, neighbor, it has nothing to do with your title. It has nothing to do with your status. You don't lose your status because you're serving. You don't lose who you are because you're serving. You don't lose your reputation because you're serving. And sometimes God will cause you to not serve John. Sometimes God will cause you, that's all right, to not serve James. Sometimes God will make you serve Peter's and Judas's. These are the individuals that don't like you, and yet you are on to them, and yet they're next in line for your service. The Bible says you can't return back to the status unless you finish washing feet. I wish I had somebody here. High five your neighbor next door and say, neighbor, I don't care what you are going through. I don't care if folk leave you hostage. I don't care what lack you are experiencing. I don't ever want you to discredit your assignment because you are going through hell and high water. You can still return to your place of status. Shake your neighbor next door and say, neighbor, keep on washing feet. You ain't losing your rhythm. You ain't losing your momentum. You can still put on your regalia. You can still garb up. I wish I shake your neighbor one more time. Come on, this is a shake your neighbor church. I need you to touch your neighbor next door and say, neighbor, I can still get back in place. I don't lose my place because I'm washing feet. I don't lose my blessing because I'm washing feet. I need you to touch yourself and say, self, because I'm serving my enemy, I'm about to be in my set place. I'm about to experience my due season. Oh, preach it like you feel it. Let me throw my hat in the air. I need some help now. Where are my riders? Look at your neighbor one more time and say, neighbor, you don't lose your status because you're serving. But then can I close with this? Oh, can I be Baptist just for a minute? In verse 9, Jesus says, after he finished washing feet, return back to the table, fully robed, fully in gear. He says, if you do, verses 1 through 16, are you praying with me? You will be blessed if you do it. I need you to shake your neighbor and say, neighbor, I think I'm next in line for a big blessing because I learned how to serve my enemy. I think I'm next in line. I don't need no prophet to tell me that I'm next in line. When I look back in the history of the hell I've been through, I come to serve notice that I'm next in line for a miracle. Do I have any cosigners? I brought my receipts. The Bible says, when the enemy comes in like a flood, he will raise up a standard. Are you praying, oh enemy? I brought some proof that no weapon, no weapon that's formed against me will be able to prosper. If I do these things, if I keep on serving, I'm setting myself up for next in line blessing. Are you praying with me? And so don't allow the enemy to talk you out of serving your Judases. Don't allow the enemy to talk you out of serving your Peterses. Are you praying with me? I know they curse. I know they cut off ears. I know they lie like Judas. Didn't speak the truth over your life. I know you are innocent. You didn't do anything. And they accuse you. And yet, you still have to serve. I'm doing it. Not just because of them. I'm doing it because I want to be blessed by the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Do I have any cosigners? I'm about to leave. I'm about to leave. But serving the Lord will pay off after a while. By and by, weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. Say yeah. He'd have lost his mind. That's all right. Say yeah. Can I be Baptist? I know he's all right. Can I be Baptist? I know he's all right. Say, he walks with me. He talks with me. He tells me that I am his own. Are you his own? Don't fool me now. Say yeah. I got to get to heaven. See, that's the problem. We forget. Some of y'all went to Beyonce concert. Don't say nothing. You were loud. And when she told you to freeze, you froze. You did. Some of y'all went to the baseball game. And when the Rockets were winning, whatever. You cheered for them. Texans. And now when we get up in here, we forget the read with comprehension. I get excited, but I give you something to get excited about. Worst thing I can do is excite you and you know nothing. You celebrate after the information. You celebrate after you eat. So when you drink the liquor, all right. You got to know when to celebrate and what for. I celebrate. That's my celebration. I'm like loud. I'm intoxicated on a new wine. This wine don't have no hangovers. Man, when you go to sleep in the Word, you don't wake up with a headache. One sister tell me, she says, I go to sleep with my praise music on. I ain't fighting no demons. Some of y'all know clawing at night. You'll never be able to help nobody because you think you are all of that spiritually. And the Bible says we are filthy rags and dirty t-shirts. You'll never be able to win the kingdom unless you come where they are. Unless you go where they are. See, in order for us to meet the unchurched, you got to go in their world to bring them into your world. Jesus never did go to church. It was the religious people that had a problem with him sitting with the heathens and called him Beelzebub. Because we feel that they got to come to us. That's backwards. We have a job. To whom have you served today, this week? I ain't talking about your family members because they always begging. That's why we don't have nothing. You need to like lose their number. I'm talking about the unchurched folk. I'm praying that God will send me some unsaved folk because they know where I'm coming from. When I talk about where my ride is at, they know how to co-sign that. See, we've gotten so church until we've lost our joy, our fun. We don't even show our pearly whites because we feel like spirituality is being serious. And the Bible says, he that enthrones laughs. Bible says the joy of the Lord in his presence is the fullness of joy. It is our strength. If you're planning on getting to heaven, there's going to be plenty of laughter. We're going to be laughing at the devil. People will follow you if you be kind. People will follow you if you feed them kindness. Even when they don't deserve it, feed them kindness and see what happens. The Spirit of God have me lingering. I know the wait 10 minutes is over, and please forgive you me, but you're here now, so I might as well just chop you. I'm gonna cut you open, and I'm going to release word in you, because when you leave today, you're gonna hunt for somebody to serve. There's not a day go by that I don't bless somebody that I don't know. And I know that, you have to be careful. Be careful of the times and seasons and all of that. But we need to be blessing somebody. In the grocery store, you see a person that's struggling with that, their change. I was at the grocery store Thursday. The old woman that was before me, along with her husband, they had a card. And you know how you insert the card in the machine? And you have to sign the name. It took that elderly man to sign his name forever and some change in Chinese money. And he's just, And I was looking. And his wife came over. She was old. I can't stand people looking at our signature. And she looked at me. I said, oh, Jesus. Because you know them old folk carry peace. This is honest God truth. And the Lord says, give her $100. I was like Gideon. I need you to wet the ground. And then after God read it, he says, I need you to try it. So I walked up to him. I'm only giving you this so that you can understand the importance. I'm going to tell you, this is the honest God truth. I'm not making this up. I walked up to her. I said, the Lord told me to bless you. She said, no. I said, no, ma'am, you can't rob my blessing. Please. You know, she opened that hand. Thank you, son. God bless you. Now, before she cussed me, the Bible says he'll make your enemies your what?
Heavens are open.
All right, this is honest God truth. Friday morning, somebody cashed at me. Three times as much as what I gave. Unsolicited. But even 24 hours. See, when you obey the promptness of God's voice, you put demands on the provision of God. I'm only talking to all of you. I want you to choose somebody this week that you don't know that you can be a blessing. Serve them with a kind word, but do something. Give them what they didn't have. If they need a smile, you give them yours. Let me tell you something. You're going to set yourself up. If you do these things, verse 17, blessings will come if you do this. You got to find somebody to be a blessing to besides your relatives. Besides your children. Be a blessing to somebody. I don't care if it's $1, $5. Kind word, a Hallmark card, do something that's going to serve God's people, God's children, and God's creation. Not everybody is God's children. But everybody is God's creation. Y'all listen to what I'm saying? So, Father, you told me to take this time and to make it more applicable and challenge every person under the sound of my voice to set them up for uncommon favor with the blessings of Abraham in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. I pray that there are several of you that you've been debating whether or not if you want to join this church by way of membership. I want you to make a response right now. Come down this aisle, the edge of the aisle, the edge of this podium, whoever you are. What are you waiting on? Make it happen. You don't have me preaching this hard and then we don't respond to the voice call of God. God is calling you. He's calling you right now. Put no pressure on anybody. Don't look at the size. Look at the substance. I was telling the pastor just the other day, I would rather have the presence of God in a church than to have a whole crowd at church with no presence. Because then yokes can never be done. Deliverance can never take. All you're going to get is a sermon, but no transformation. It's the Spirit of God, the anointing of God breaks the yoke. So I want you right now to make a response so your life can change and take a metamorphosis. In Jesus' name, we thank you now. Father, as we leave this place of never from your proximity, Lord, we really do pray for traveling grace and tickets, delays, and more accidents. Those of you, if this is your day, this is your week to give financially, I want you to do that right now. Every person, I want you to give financially. I know that we're way over time, but sometimes overtime is time that you have. Those of you who are online, I want you to be a blessing to the body of Christ. Begin to sow your tithes and offerings right now. You're here. You're online. You're on a safe site. Be a blessing to the body of Christ. I thank you. Y'all give it up for the media ministry. God bless them, these young people. They're doing a great job, a good job. They're here every Sunday. I was at the church here, and I was leaving out probably about 4, maybe 5 o'clock, and I saw Brother Darrell that he was coming in. He says, Bishop, I'm here so I can set up. Every week, these young people come, and they labor. Amen?
Yeah.
that. So we thank God for Jesus. Were you blessed today? I know I gave you a whole lot of info because we got so much to cover. Glad to see my dear brother. God bless you. Those of you, if this is your week to pay tithe, we want you to do that. We welcome you in the beauty of His holiness. We thank you so very much for your coming. In fact, City Cathedral Church, let's give them a great welcome. All of our visitors, all of our visitors, all of our visitors, all of our visitors. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Amen. Come on, let's be a blessing. Everybody stand. Let's follow these ushers. We have the blessed receptacles. We want you to be a blessing. We welcome you, all of you, God's daughters, God's sons. Thank you. Thank you for being a part of this programmatic thrust. And don't forget, right after service, for about 20 minutes, maybe 30 minutes of your time, we're having the Empowerment Symposium. Look at God. This for me? All right. I wanted to ask. I don't want to put anything in my pocket that was meant for the church. Thank you, Deacon. Thank you, those that sister in the game. Thank you very much. Give me a tithe envelope. Give me an envelope, every person.
Lord Jehovah, you. Oh, I trust in
God bless you.
Oh, I believe you are the God of miracles.
Okay. Thank you.
You are the God of wonders. You are the
everybody
God
stand. Thank you. You. I love you, your new wife. Hallelujah. Anyone else? We are going to receive our wonderful. I asked them to do something for me. Sister Karma is here too as well. Thank you, my dear sister. We just love you. We thank you for being part of us. Amen.
I trust.